How many people here did Shakespeare at school? Good. How many people hated it? One. Is that all? Not a bad ratio, a couple, okay. I meet quite a few people who say, oh, I had a terrible time with Shakespeare at school. We sat in the classroom and passed the book from hand to hand and read a line each and then passed it on. And we didn't know what we were reading or why we were doing it, and we just had to learn slabs of it for homework or sometimes as a punishment, which of course is a great way of encouraging the love of something. But I was one of the lucky ones. I had two fantastic teachers, English teachers, throughout my high school years, men who loved literature, poetry, Shakespeare and theatre, and they encouraged me in my ambition to be an actor. So it's largely thanks to them and to Shakespeare that I've had a very satisfying career in the theatre and a lifetime of inspiration and motivation and some understanding of my place in the world. In short, Shakespeare has helped me to become a humanist. And what is a humanist? Well, it's a term that was very popular during the Renaissance in Europe, but it goes way back to the ancient philosophers like Socrates and Plato. And you can be many different shades of humanist. You can be an atheist humanist or an agnostic humanist. You can even be a Christian humanist. That is someone who appreciates Christian values but doesn't abide by the dogma or theology. For myself, I would define a humanist as someone who believes that there is no supernatural deity, there is no great plan for the universe, and that life is meaningless except for whatever meaning we give it ourselves. We're on our own, we write our own scripts, and we are responsible for our own actions. And since there is no grand plan, we are also responsible for our fellow human beings, for all living creatures, and for nature itself, because we are simply a part of nature. And if we damage nature, then we are just damaging ourselves and the prospects of our species for survival. Now, the idea of living in a so-called meaningless universe might strike some people as a recipe for despair. But I think we can find enormous consolation and inspiration in science, in philosophy, and in great works of art, in the works of poets, composers, painters, who demonstrate the amazing capacity of the human spirit and imagination, and who encourage us to celebrate life and to infuse our own lives with meaning and purpose. And I've drawn a lot of my inspiration from the works of Shakespeare, with whom I've walked on a daily basis side by side for the last 60 years, acting, directing, and producing his plays. Why Shakespeare? Well, for a start, he had an extraordinary curiosity. He was curious about everything, about nature, about science, technology, exploration, but mostly about people. And he had a very healthy skepticism, always questioning, challenging received ideas and opinions, and an amazing empathy. No one said a greater understanding of the workings of the human mind and heart. And he could put himself with equal ease inside the mind of a crazy old king or a pathological killer or a young girl in love. And more than that, he had a special regard for outsiders, people who were rejected or abused by society. When I played the role of Shylock, the Jewish moneylender in The Merchant of Venice, I spent a lot of time researching Jewish history, going to synagogue, mingling with Jewish families, because I wanted to get right inside that culture and understand as much as I could what it was about and how Shylock felt, how it would feel to be abused and spat upon by society. In his play, Sir Thomas More, Shakespeare defends the refugees who were flocking into London at the time, fleeing persecution at home. And of course, they were met with hostile crowds shouting, "They've come here to take our jobs," a familiar cry. And in the play, Sir Thomas More rebukes the rioters, saying, "How would you feel to be a refugee? Put yourself in their place. How would you feel to be abused and rejected and refused asylum? This is a sign of your monstrous inhumanity." It's a speech very, very pertinent to our times. But I think I touched Shakespeare's humanity most closely when I played the role of Prospero in The Tempest. Prospero is the great magician who has gathered all his enemies onto an island and he intends to take revenge on them for the wrongs they've committed against him. But at the last moment, he's stopped by his better angel, Ariel, who says to him, "Sir, your charm so strongly works them that if you now beheld them, your affections would become tender." And Prospero says, "Dost thou think so, spirit?" And Ariel says, "Mine would, sir, were I human." And Prospero answers, "And mine shall. Hast thou, which art but air, a touch, a feeling of their afflictions? And shall not myself, one of their kind, be kindlier moved than thou art? Though with their high wrongs I am struck to the quick, yet with my nobler reason, against my fury, do I take part. The rarer action is in virtue than in vengeance. Go, release them, Ariel." Prospero has come to realize that the island is actually a metaphor for himself, and he'll never get off that island and rejoin the mainstream of humanity until he learns to forgive and move on. And I think there Shakespeare may be echoing the words of his great contemporary, John Donne, who wrote, "No man is an island entire of itself. Every man is a piece of the continent, a part of the main. Every man's death diminishes me because I am involved in mankind. Therefore, never send to know for whom the bell tolls. It tolls for thee." We are all a piece of the continent, a part of the main, part of one large human family. And we're on our own. No one's looking after us. We have to look after each other. And we can only do that if, like Prospero, we give up certain things. If we give up anger and pride and vengeance. And in that way, we can serve the human family. 60 years of working with Shakespeare have taught me a lot about how the world works, about how history is made by strong individuals and how great oratory can change the course of history. It's taught me a lot about leadership and the qualities that are needed to create and sustain an organization. And it's opened up my imagination and taught me life lessons in empathy, in natural justice, and inclusiveness. And it's also encouraged in me a boundless curiosity and a healthy skepticism. And for all those life lessons, I am eternally grateful. Thank you.